Our first speaker this morning is from India, from southern India, and Pastor Brian Coelho is the overseeing pastor there. So I'd like to ask all the Indian pastors from any part of India, if you were here with us, would you just stand up? People, not just pastors, but the Indians, ladies also. You add a lot to our convention every year when you come from so far away with a living faith. And also we feel so connected because I know you listen in India to our Sunday morning messages. Which one, Pastor Brian, do you listen to? The 9 o'clock one? This one? So what time is it in India? 6:30? So I've been told that you actually stand and worship with us. So they sing the same songs we are singing here in Baltimore at the 9 o'clock service. They're singing in India, is it? And then they listen to the message. Is that correct? And then do you have your own offering, or are you sending your offerings over to us? So then you have your offering, right? Do you have an offering or no? No offering. And then you have a wrap. So this is amazing, and we appreciate it. Pastor Brian's assistant is Pastor Benny Zechariah, and he studied here in Bible College some years ago, so welcome him.
In Bangalore, we have a wooden pulpit, so it's good to hide behind. It doesn't work here, so anyway. Greetings from Bangalore. Hi, guys, if you're watching. Just really amazing to be here, and love from the body to each one of you. Okay, just a small verse, just a small portion, a big verse, but a small portion. Proverbs 29 and verse 21. Says, he that delicately bringeth up a servant from a child shall have him become his son at the length. I thought over it and thought, what must this verse be? He that deals gently with a servant from his childhood shall have him become his son at the length. Beautiful verse on a Father's Day to consider, isn't it? Now, when Jesus Christ came into the world, he perfected us in a unique relationship with his Father. And his Father became our Father in a relational sense. In Galatians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. The Bible says we got adopted as sons, adult sons, into God's royal family. What more can we ask of, isn't it? It's really phenomenal. This could not be accomplished under the law, but it could happen under grace. And from a positional standpoint, God sees no difference between us and his Son. That is why the Bible says in Romans chapter 8, we are joint heirs with Christ. I just remember a statement Dr. Stevens made long time back. I think it was in the year 2002 when he gave a series on his testimony. He said one of the things that revolutionized his life as a man of God was when he got a revelation of God as his Father. Confidence, a kind of a holy arrogance. You know, you stand up to things which is not of God. There is a kind of an access we have with him. And it's so beautiful. But along the same lines in Proverbs chapter 29, verse 21, Christ also left for us an amazing pattern for us to be groomed in our calling as believers. And this pattern involves the principle of spiritual fathers. It says here, he that delicately or gently bringeth up his servant from his childhood shall have him become his son at length. And an application for us, we are aware as a ministry who understands this principle in the book of 1 Timothy, in the book of 2 Timothy, in the book of Titus. It is just so phenomenally put all over the pages in the Bible, this father-son relationship. And thank God, Dr. Stevens was a man like that. And we in body in Bangalore can wholeheartedly say thank you, Pastor Schaller, the elders, the leaders, the administration, the body here, because we have a covering with all of you. And thank you for praying, thank you for giving, thank you for your support, thank you for your love, thank you for everything. Sometimes I'm tempted to think maybe Pastor Schaller in his, I like the way, just to see the way he loves Indians. Maybe in his previous birth he was an Indian. And then later on he reincarnated as an American, you know. So, but I love this heart connection. He comes and we are having such a celebration around the Word of God. Sorry, Lisa. having such an amazing celebration around the Word of God. And since last May, we had Pastor Shibili visit us in December and Pastor Fredel is in May. And this connection just keeps us on. And I look at this. They have the gift of what it means to nurture us and groom us in our calling so much so that as God raises us up, we become their sons and daughters in the faith, spiritually speaking. And thank God for that. Thank God for that heritage. And we just always love it when we plug in to hear the message and just to see the faces here. We're just so thankful that we have this body here as an amazing covering. And Pastor Brian does the same thing. He always gets us connected with the messages here, with the body of Christ here and the fellowship here. And thank you so much. We have no words to thank you, but we just sense that we have spiritual fathers in the faith who have grooming us and pushing us creatively to kind of go forward beyond ourselves and trust God, even though they are here and we are there, to trust God for what God has for us in the plan of God in a country like India. And thank you, Body of Christ. Thank you so much. And thanks for everything. God bless.
Right, so I have a word for you, okay? So, and it's not an announcement. So if you could open your Bibles to Proverbs, which seems to be a place we like to be today. We're going to Proverbs 17. A few weeks ago, we had a message here on humility. And, you know, It's a great thing to think about humility. Did I say Proverbs 17? I meant Proverbs 6. And then verse 17 or verse 16, we could start there. Gives a catalog here for us. You know, there is like this thing that's outside the Bible called the seven deadly sins. Have you heard that? You know, adultery, gluttony, there's a couple others. You know, they've made movies about it and stuff like that. But it's really not biblical. That came from someone else. This is the Bible description of what God hates. Six things does the Lord hate, and seven are an abomination to him. And he begins with this, a proud look. And I like to think of these things in looking at the literature that we have from the Hebrews and how it's constructed. In particular, this literature in the middle of the Bible, this wisdom and poetry. And it seems to me that this is one, and then two by two by two. Because the proud look really triggers the rest of what is happening in these other things that the Lord hates. The proud look comes first, really. It's the idea of contempt. I read something a while ago and shared it at the marriage getaway, and it's really comes back again and again as we see what's happening in the world, because there's a lot of contempt. You know, the single most debilitating thing, the thing that destroys a marriage, is contempt. It's the moment when one person in the relationship begins to think in his mind or her mind that I am better and I can do better. And there's another part of that too that we see throughout the world, the proud looks. It's I am better, I can do better, and I know better, and you better listen to me. It is like the proud look, and it informs the rest of this, because if you have a proud look, if there is contempt in my heart, I know better, then I can lie to you. And then the second one here, a proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked imaginations, feet that are swift in running to mischief, a false witness that speaks lies and sows discord among the brethren. Lies and death are the immediate result, and we see it. You know, innocent blood, we can really think about it. Like, why do we see people so carelessly killing people, like happened in South Carolina, middle of a prayer meeting? A young man, you know, fueling his mind with thoughts of superiority and proud looks, you know, kills people at a church. And we see it in the news. And there are a lot of, you know, one of the former governor of Maryland says, I'm angry, used another word. But what are you angry about? You know, he's not angry at the crack in his own heart or the failure in his own person or, you know, the failure of some of the information that has been given to try and corral society in some way. What's he angry about? He's angry. He's angry for all the wrong reasons. He doesn't feel the sense of hurt for the people. Innocent blood, hands shed innocent blood. You know, we see it whenever we look at a clinic that ends the life of someone who's not born. And we use those terms. We understand that spirit matters. Spirit apparently matters, doesn't it? Because we're seeing this. If the spirit in you is not given to God, and the spirit in you says that I would rather be woman rather than man, that's valuable. If the spirit in you, another news story, if the spirit in you says, I do not want to be a Swedish, Czech, German, I'd rather be an African American, then spirit apparently matters. And this opens up a whole other argument, because if spirit matters, then every spark of life that happens in every womb around the world, there is spirit. And so the world likes to confuse itself. It lies because of the proud look, and then it sheds innocent blood because of the proud look. And then the next couple here are interesting, because it says there is wicked imaginations and feet that are swift that run to mischief. The lie, the pride, the lies and pride, there's an energy, and that energy creates imaginations. Those imaginations create mischief, and you're just wondering why there's like 922 TV channels. How many grew up with four? You know, my mom let me watch Little Rascals and Gilligan's Island and kick me out of the house every summer. That's the way it went. You know, that's all we could watch, those, you know, those kind of things. But now there's like all kinds, you know, numerous video games, all these kind of things, imaginations, because the lie and the pride has an energy to it. It needs a place to go. But then the last couple maybe are the most informative for us, because when proud looks enter a place like ours or enter a heart like mine that has been given to Christ, and it can, then what do I do? I can be a false witness. I could speak lies about the true nature and character of the finished work of Christ. I could, very possibly, sow discord among the brethren. You know, I'm reading Proverbs 21 today because it's the 21st. I like to read through Proverbs one chapter at a time. It's good to keep my mind instructed. And I reach one of those verses that I really like. It's in the Bible twice. It says on verse 9, it says, "It's better to dwell in the corner of the housetop than in a wide room with a brawler." It says a brawling woman. But, you know, I've met men who are like brawling women. I've met people like that. Not in this church, not in this organization. Oh, geez. Nobody in this organization is like that. But just think about the corner. Like, do you feel like right now, if, you know, the Supreme Court is considering some things, you know, and they're going to consider some things about, like, what marriage is. And that's, like, a big thing for us. We're praying that these people, supposedly wise men and women, will make the kind of decision that God approves, but they may not. And we would be pushed to the corner. Is that a bad thing? It seems to me from the Bible, because it says this exact verse twice, Proverbs 21:9, Proverbs 25:24, it's better to dwell in the corner of the housetop. Maybe being in the corner is going to be a good thing for us. Because look at the view. Look at what we can see from there. And that we come together here this week for definition. And it's awesome to get definition. When you're in the corner, when you're on the corner of some place like that, don't look down. You know. There's a great picture in my family of me holding on to the side of the Eiffel Tower, you know, as I get off the elevator, like working my way around because I think I could fall off. I have a problem with heights, apparently. The Bay Bridge is one of those things, too. You know, anyone who's driven with me, my feet shake a little bit. It's like kind of interesting to go up high like that. But if you're in the corner, you better concentrate. It's better to be on that corner. There's the first floor, there's the second floor, and then I guess I'm adding. There's the corner of the housetop. It's like that place that we can see. We are here, like at the corner of the housetop, I think. You know, Jesus was taken to the pinnacle of the temple, right? The pinnacle of the temple. And Satan said, "Throw yourself down." And we only have like a couple of exchanges. I could see Jesus maybe playing with the devil a little bit, saying, "No, hey, the view here is awesome. This is the corner of the housetop." And I think like a church is like that. We are a frame of reference, and we bring people in, and they learn the Bible, and they go from the first floor life, which is just natural, to the second floor life, to the corner. And Jesus is on the pinnacle. And he said, "Why would I bring myself down to that level? For what? Just a display of power and miracle? That would be something?" Jesus said, "No, it's better here." That the corner, being on the corner, is the place to be. The view is great. The concentration is necessary. And I can see. I don't need to be in a wide place where there are a lot of opinions and everything like that. And I can start brawling and everything. And I could start thinking with contempt that I know more, that I am better, that I can do better. And what would that do to me? What would that do to me? It could make me like mock people. It could make me mock people who come to church like with a devotion and a heart after God and come because they just can't live without teaching from the scripture. It's like I like it better in the corner of the housetop than down in the lower place where we have to brawl and try and prove ourselves and figure out our opinions. So I think this is going to be a great week for us to look, seek those things that are above is the theme for our convention. And what better place to seek those things that are above than in the corner, right? Now, this is like a little corner. And we are making a difference. It's like the world's going crazy, but we are the voices of sanity because we want to bring people back to the place where they understand that it all starts with your proud look. Look, it says verse 20 to finish here of Proverbs 6. It says, "My son, keep the father's commandment and forsake not the law of your mother." And that's the key. I got a proud look, but what's the commandment of the father? Have no gods before me. Love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. This is the secret. The proud look is dangerous for me. I can do it. And when I see that, I need to go to the corner. I need to look up. Let God show me what he's doing. Let me understand. This is the time for that this week, where God will take us up and let us see everything that he's doing in us, above us. And it's so amazing. Nehemiah did not come down to the valley when he was doing a great work. Jesus did not come down, throw himself down from the pinnacle to make a spectacle of himself. And we don't have to come down from there, regardless of what decisions may be made or laws may be passed. We can stay up there and the heathen will see that we have something. They are looking for people who know how to stay on the corner and not fall off. We have a purpose and a call from God. And it's amazing to be in this place at this time in this week. Thank you.
Hey, it's time to collect your money. Yes! Let's get an amen. Hey, here's a fun thought. I mean, it's probably really self-serving, but like today, special dispensation, take your offering, spend it on your father. If you don't have one, give more. I think I would come out okay. Will my family stand up? I just take them in and introduce them. I think most of them are here. That means you have to stand up. Let's see. David from Peru with his new wife, Helm, just married 2 weeks ago, are here. Wow. Pastor John and Rach came up from Tennessee. My beautiful wife, 40 years. Wow. We were like married in the womb or something, I think. And, of course, these tremendous services. Servants here, Kristen, Ryan. Regina just returned from Budapest. And Rebecca is here, and Jennifer, and is James sleeping? Really? Yeah. But Ben is here, so thank God for a godly family, huh? Okay, offering. One verse, quickly, in 2 Corinthians 9:7. And we want to look at this verse. Like it says, as every man is purposed in his heart. And let's realize it's not our heart purposing our giving, because you know that rascal, it's deceitfully wicked above all things. And you could quickly find a reason not to give. So easy to do, isn't it? So we don't let our hearts purpose, but we purpose in our hearts. We say, heart, by the grace of God, by the Spirit of God, this is how I give. That one thought will save you. Because you know, if it's a heart decision, you are in trouble your whole given life. Because there's always something going on in there. There's always some necessity. There's always some need. But by the grace of God, to purpose ahead of time. Here's what, like, my wife and I do. This is, you know, we do personal things with giving. We pre-tithe on everything. Like, we're going away for a couple weeks. We tithe in advance. We go on vacation. We tithe in advance. And it's like, we don't let the heart decide. We do before the heart. Look, heart. This is the way it is. It makes life so easy, right? And that's what he's saying here. You, like, by the grace of God, you know, you purpose your heart, you will give. Because here's what God wants. We all want it in verse 8. He is able to make all grace abound. You mean he's associating that with money? Oh, my God. I didn't know it could be that way. But he's doing it, isn't he? Get it right. I mean, I know you do. Great giving church. But, you know, we make our hearts a heart. And you know what? I'm going to receive all grace. And all sufficiency? Is it happening? Yes. Right? Yes. Tell yourself, yes, my God is all sufficient. He's providing my every need. And it's not based upon how I feel or what my heart said. It's based upon the sufficiency of Christ. Father, we just pray for our offering. I ask you, bless the givers in the name of Christ. Amen.
Good morning. My apologies to those who were expecting Pastor Schaller to walk up here. Maybe you've come like 10,000 miles to hear Pastor Schaller preach, and you get me. So my apologies to you. But I will say that if you hang around till 11 and come to the 11 o'clock service, which will happen right here soon after we're done, you will get to hear Pastor Schaller preach. So, and he asked me to introduce myself, which is pretty, I don't know, it feels kind of awkward, but my name is Pastor Bob Colban. A lot of you know me, maybe, and I'm an elder here in the church and one of the trustees, and He told me to say all that stuff. I'm not trying to talk about myself. And So anyway, I'm here. He's over there. And and you're all stuck in your seats. So I will notice whoever gets up and runs out the door and comes back in an hour. So, wow, this is amazing, actually, to speak in front of all of you and for a few minutes. And I want to start with, maybe I'll just say this, because it's Father's Day, and actually my message has nothing to do with fathers, and I apologize for that also. It's not like I didn't know it was Father's Day, but I never even thought about it, that I should say something about it. But I'll just say this, and if your father's alive, then call him today, tell him how much you love him. If you haven't spoken to your father in years, today make that call. I had a great relationship with my dad. My dad passed away last August. This is my first Father's Day without my dad. He died. He was 88 years old. And more than anything, I wish I could call him today and say happy Father's Day. And so I just encourage you, if you maybe there's a little rift in your family with your dad, and it's all so small when you think about it. And so call your dad today. Tell him how much you love him, how much you appreciate him. Even if you don't, make it up. No, I'm just kidding. Lie to him. No, I'm not. Don't do that. Don't do that. Just love your dad today, you know. So just a thought for this morning's service. Here's an interesting story. This is a true story. I used to do a Bible study down at a building downtown on the east side of Baltimore. We call it 101 Monford. And it was an interesting neighborhood, and we had a lot of, over the years, very diverse group of people that came in. We really didn't exclude anybody, and we left the door open many times, and people would just walk in, and that can be dangerous at times. I don't mean physically, but you never know who's going to walk in the door. But we had an amazing time there, and God really moved, and God touched many lives. And I was thinking this morning of this one gentleman that my wife and I had visited maybe 3 or 4 times. We met him knocking on his door, and he had previously received Christ. And it was hard to get him to come to the Bible study, and he came one time kind of late. And the next time he came, we're having a time of worship, and he's there. His name was Leonard, and he was an awesome guy. So we finished the song part of the Bible study, and I get up to preach just like this. And as I said like the first word, he got up and ran out the door. And we had had a lot of unique things happen at the Bible study over the course of a number of years, but that was a first for me, to have somebody get up and run out the door. And I thought, man, of course, you're self-conscious, you think, is my preaching that bad, you know? And so what do? You're standing there. This guy gets up, runs out the door. It's not like nobody else noticed. And so I said to the song leader, sing another song, and I ran out the door after him and ran down the street. He was pretty quick, actually, and I wasn't, but about a block and a half away, I caught up with him and tackled him on the ground, and then... No, he was sitting on a stoop about a block away. And I'm like, I mean, that's bizarre, isn't it? Somebody get up and run out of your church or run out of your Bible study. And so I sat next to him. I said, Leonard, I said, what's going on? What's the matter? And he said this to me, and I never forgot it. He said, I am not worthy to be in there. And it broke my heart, really, it did, when I thought about that. And, you know, I was thinking this morning of Genesis, I think it's Genesis 3:15, after Adam and Eve fell, and they hid themselves from God. And when God said, why did you hide yourself? And they said, because we were naked and ashamed, and we hid yourself. And God said this to them. He said, who told you that you're naked? And I say the same thing I didn't say that exact words to Leonard, but I said in a sense, like, who told you you were unworthy? And it was just, I don't remember, it's been a while ago, whether he even came back in or not, but it stuck with me that he felt as a believer that he was unworthy to be and really approach God and be worthy to even sit and listen to God. And why is that? It's because this is what I think, and this is what I think the challenge is for all of us as believers, is that we know ourselves so well. And because we know ourselves so well, we condemn ourselves and many times feel unworthy to even approach God. Does that make sense to everybody? Has anybody ever experienced that, or am I just preaching to myself here? I mean, isn't that true? And this is interesting. Like, I read this morning. This was in an Oswald Chambers devotional. And he said this. This is a quote from his devotional this morning. The continual grubbing on the inside to see whether we are what we ought to be generates a self-centered, morbid type of Christianity, not the robust, simple life of a child of God. I like the way he said that. I like that choice of words. The continual grubbing around on the inside. And what does that mean? That's like us turning our eyes and looking inward and kind of grubbing around in there. And what are we going to find? We're going to find every fault that we ever had. And then when we think on that and we start to think that way, then what happens? We either declare, there's two things that come out of that. One, we grub around inside and we say, huh, I'm pretty good. And we become self-righteous. Or we grub around inside, which is what most of us do, and we say we are unworthy. And I'm not talking about unworthy in the right way that we would look at that word, but I'm talking about unworthy in the sense of a false identity, okay? Because when we say that we are unworthy, we are saying something about ourselves that contradicts what God says about us. And that's really what if I could boil down what I want to say in a nutshell, it's that. Are we going to believe what the world, the flesh, and the devil say about who we are now as believers, or are we going to believe what God says about us? And it says in Ephesians, if you want to turn to Ephesians chapter 2, I just want to read a verse there. In Ephesians chapter 2, in the verse 1, 2, 3, it talks about who we were. Verse 2, in times past we walked, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the sons of disobedience. This is who we were, and this is true about who we were. Among whom also we all had our manner of life in times past, the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But verse 4 comes in. It's like, yeah, that's who we were. And you know what? We acknowledge who we were. We don't run from who we were. We realize that we used to walk our life, we dwelt in the world, we lived according to the lusts of the flesh, and that's who we were. But then something happened to us, as it says in verse, but God, who is rich in mercy for his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, has made us alive or quickened us together with Christ. And by grace you are saved, and has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That's the reality now of who we are in Christ. You know, and so... But as we go through our Christian life, we are constantly being bombarded with a message from the devil, from the world, but then also what I'm talking about today is internally through us of our unworthiness. And you know, there's a brother that comes here at the 11 o'clock service, and I've known him for about 15 years. And he's faithful here, and he's amazing. But he got to the point in his Christianity where he gave up 15 years ago. You know why he gave up? because he couldn't measure up. Okay? He gave up because he couldn't measure up. And he could have become a casualty, one of those people that you meet, oh, yeah, I haven't gone to church for 15 years, I can't be a Christian, I tried it and I failed at it. Well, where does all that come from? Is that what God says in the Word of God about us? It's not God's confession about us. That's what the world and the devil have to say, and that's what inwardly our old man is confessing to us. Like, you can't go to church. Do you know what you did? You know what you said? You know what you thought? You know how you felt? You know what you said to your wife? Do you know what you, how you treated your kids? I mean, this is all those projections that say to us that you are not who God says you are. And you know what? I just want to say to you, if you don't already know this, they're a pack of lies. It's lies that come. And you know what? All those things could be true, but it's not who we are. And all those things, you know, it's not like it's not like God looks at us every day and says, how did you do today? You know, could you imagine if we lived in this insecurity with God where at the end of the day he would evaluate us based upon how we did? Well, wouldn't you just look forward to putting your pillow down, your head down on the pillow and thinking about how did I do today and how does God think about me? But you know, we put our head down on the pillow at night and we know that we are secure in God's love for us because we haven't made ourselves a new creature. He has made us a new creature. You know, we haven't done anything except received from him something that has changed our lives. Not talking about changing the flesh, but made us a new creature in Christ. And that's the reality of who we are. Not what our flesh is. You know, look in the mirror in the morning and, you know, what that person in the mirror speaks back to you, many different things. And most of them are pretty negative. But, you know, God speaks to us from his word and says things that are positive. Right, that you are this is 6025 Moravia Park Drive. We're sitting here physically, but the reality in the mind of God is that we are all seated above in heavenly places. That's true. You know, you might say, well, come on, that's pie in the sky. That's like hyper spirituality. It's not. It's the truth about what God says about us, that we are kings, that we are priests, that we are part of a royal priesthood. You know, this is who we are. And, you know, the devil is not going to reinforce what God says about us. You know, the world is not going to reinforce what God says about us. And I'm telling you, your old man is not going to reinforce what God says about us. And you know who's going to reinforce what God says about us? The body of Christ. The Word of God is going to reinforce it. Hearing preaching is going to reinforce it. You know, I was thinking yesterday morning, had a busy week like many of you have, and yesterday morning I was thinking, I said to my wife, I don't know if I'm going to go on outreach this morning. I'm just beat. I'm tired. A little, you know, just like didn't want to go. And then this thought came into my head, like, if I go, I will be around the body of Christ. If I am around the body of Christ, I will get built up because they will reinforce what God says about me. They will reinforce that. So I need to go on outreach. I wasn't even thinking about winning souls or anything. I said, I need to go to be around you, because when I am around you, you reinforce in me what God says about me. And I thank you for that. And hopefully we do that to each other. We reinforce, because who else is going to say, hey, Pastor Bob, you're awesome. Thank you. I love you. Thank you. You know, I see Christ in you. You know, I can see Christ in every one of you much easier than I can see Christ in myself. Isn't that so true? I can believe God for every one of you, no matter what your situation is, no matter what you're going through, no matter how discouraged you are, no matter what you've been doing. I still see the potential of Christ in every one of you. But you know what? When I look in the mirror, I have a hard time saying that about myself. That's why when those projections come, I need to look at what God says about me in the Word of God and reflect on that and say, hey, you know, these projections that are coming are not what God says about me. And that's why it says in the, I wrote the verse, 2 Corinthians 10:5. You don't have to turn there, I'll read it to you. Casting down imaginations. Casting down. I remember looking that up once, and it was like taking a book and throwing it on the ground. That's what it means to cast, like taking something and throwing it on the ground. Like literally, that's what it means. Casting down or throwing down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. So when we start to think about ourselves and say that we are unworthy, well, what is that? Isn't that a thought? Doesn't it say this? That's a thought or a high thing or imagination that is exalting itself against what God says about me. Isn't it? Man, you can't go to church. You did this. Those are all thoughts that are coming from the other kingdom, Satan's kingdom, but they are coming against what God says. So the Bible says we need to cast them down. And, throw them down. I am not receiving that. I am not going to think about that. I am not going to dwell upon that. I am not going to agree about that because my Bible and my God say something else about me. And I'm going to choose to dwell on those thoughts because those are the truth. And those, like people would say, well, you guys don't live in reality when you say you're seated above in heavenly places, like I said before. But, that reality is greater than the reality of what the world says about us, isn't it? I choose to believe what God says. Choose to cast down these thoughts that want to exalt themselves about what God says about us or what God says about another believer. And to me, in this Christian journey of some 30-something years now, that's been, in one sense, the most difficult thing for me is to think about myself the way God does. But also, it's also the thing that has sustained me. I don't know if that makes sense. It's like difficult to think of ourselves that way because we know ourselves so well, but yet when we do, that's what sustains us in this journey. That's what sustains us long-term in this journey. And so we need to continually be refreshing ourselves in what God says about us, choosing to believe what God says versus what the flesh from internal, the world, and the devil have to say about us. And casting down anything that would come against what the Word of God says about who we are in Christ. Because the reality is, I said that aloud, I'm sorry. But the truth is, that's what's real. That's what we want to dwell on, and that's what's going to sustain us in this journey. And to me, that's the greatest challenge of all of us as individual believers, is to look at ourselves in the mirror, and not necessarily say this, but maybe say, hey, you're a child of God. Like, hey, you in the mirror, you are a reflection of Jesus Christ, And when we are, I love what I wrote down Pastor Luigi's quote the other day when he spoke Wednesday night, Psalm 27:13. Oh, this is the French translation of the Greek and Hebrew transliteration of the, disregarding the English and Schofield and all of this, I'm just teasing him. But he said this. This is the way it translates in the French, I think you said, right? And it's awesome. Oh, if I was not sure of the goodness of the Lord. Think about that. If I was not sure of the goodness of the Lord. Like, if we're not sure of that, then when these projections come, we are going to entertain them about ourselves. When discouragement comes from the atmosphere or from within, we are going to entertain those things because we're not sure of the goodness of God and how God thinks about us. But when we are sure of the goodness of God and we are secure in that, then projections can be deflected because, what you're saying to me, devil, what you're saying to me, flesh, that contradicts what God says about me. And because of that, I'm going to cast that down and choose to think God's thoughts towards myself. And I think to me personally, that's the challenge, but also the blessing that keeps us, how did Chambers say? Keeps us from the continual grubbing on the inside to see whether we are what we ought to be. Because we don't want to live a self-centered, kind of insecure, morbid type of Christianity, but as he said here, we want to live the robust, simple life of the child of God. Amen? Amen. 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 Let's pray. Well, Father, we are so thankful that when we come to you, we come boldly to you, Lord. Not in fear and trembling in the negative sense, but in respect and honor and in awe of who you are. And we know that you receive us and you love us and you care for us as your children. And your thoughts towards us are only good. Your thoughts towards us are to give us an expected end. Your thoughts to us are thoughts of grace and mercy and truth. And we're so thankful for that, God, that regardless of our performance, we know that we can come to you, our Heavenly Father, and be accepted, be loved, be forgiven, be cleansed. So, Father, we thank you for that today as believers. And if you're here this morning and maybe you're not a believer, maybe you have never accepted Christ as your Savior, maybe you're not never heard anything like this before, and you're wondering, am I a child of God? Am I a believer? This morning, you can just say a prayer to God personally and ask him to be your personal Savior. And you can pray a prayer just like this and say, Dear Lord, come into my life. Lord, I ask you to come in, forgive me of my sins, cleanse me, and make me a child of God. And I receive you today as my personal Savior in Jesus' name. And if you said that prayer this morning, we just want to ask you to slip up your hand so that the ushers can see you. If you're here this morning, if you prayed that prayer, just slip up your hand. We'd like to give you a package. We'd like to talk to you. Just encourage you in this walk. Well, Father, we thank you today for your presence here today, Lord, and we just ask that you would bless the rest of this service, 11 o'clock service, 6:30, and bless the day today with our families in Jesus' name. Amen.